Hello, welcome to the Horns and Whistles Workshop YouTube channel. My name's Mark, and welcome to this video, which is a product demonstration and fitting tutorial for a new motor upgrade kit, which I've released, which is a upgrade kit for the Hornby Triang X04 motors. Now, if you don't know what an X04 motor is, it's one of these. It's a three-pole motor, which were fitted to an awful lot of Hornby Triang models back in the day, and nowadays these motors are quite dated. They don't necessarily run particularly well, even if they are well looked after. There's a lot of things they're not capable of that a modern motor is, such as a really good slow speed crawl or being converted to DCC. It's of course possible to wire these for DCC, but quite often, because the amount of current they draw, the decoders can't withstand it, and the decoders fail. So the reason I've designed this product here is A, to allow users to improve the running of their older sort of vintage models, a lot of which are more than likely to have a lot of sentimental value, perhaps have been passed down through the family, but also to allow you to bring these models up to date and run on a modern digital layout if you so wish to. So I'm just going to demonstrate how to fit these, and it is quite a simple process. So the first thing I will do is just show you what you get inside the bag. I'll then put the bag aside and we'll start disassembling the locomotive as it is. I'm giving it a bit of a clean and a strip down and removing the motor. So inside the bag, you get one of these little solder tabs here. You get 6 inches or so of wire. And then you get sort of the main event, if you like, is this five-pole skew wound motor with a worm gear pre-fitted, a flywheel pre-fitted, and pre-fitted into this plastic adapter, which will allow you to fit it in the place of the X04 motor once we remove it. So if I just put those bits and bobs to one side, and then what we'll do is start taking the locomotive apart. Now, tools wise, what you're going to need to complete this job are a few basic things. You're going to need some screwdrivers, some flat-headed screwdrivers. You're going to want an oil dropper and a pair of tweezers. You're also going to need some wire cutters and some wire strippers. You're going to need some solder and a soldering iron, which I'm not going to put in my mat because mine is plugged in, warming up. And the first tool that we're going to use is our screwdriver to take our locomotive apart. Now, if you've got a servicing cradle, I've just got a sort of foam cut-out sleeve here, it's a good idea to use one of these to hold your locomotive, particularly at this point when you're taking it apart. Now, I can't guarantee that this is the process to take all of these Triang locomotives apart. For most of the steam models, it is a fairly similar process in that you have a screw at one end and then a little tab or some sort of lugs holding the other end in. You're going to have a look at your particular model and identify how you take the body off, because taking the body off, of course, is the first thing we need to do. And on this particular one, I'm going to remove this screw here and the body will lift off front first. And there's a little washer there as well, which I don't want to lose. One thing I didn't mention in the things that you will need bit a second ago is some sort of tub to put bits and bobs in as you take them apart to make sure you don't lose anything, because much of it you're going to need back. And having removed that screw, I've realised that there is actually another one on this model just here, and I'm going to need a thinner screwdriver for that one. So a lot of these models, they will all be a little bit different in the way you take the body off. And then the front lifts off and then the back will just come off. Now, the body, you can give it a bit of a dust, a bit of a clean, bit of a wipe. If you've got a clean paintbrush or something like that, it's a good idea to give it a dust with a soft bristled paintbrush, as long as it's clean. And then you can give it just a bit of a wipe gently with some warm soapy water if it needs a bit of brightening up, as it were. So here we have your locomotive chassis and your X04 motor here. Now, it's useful at this point to briefly explain how these models work in terms of where the electricity goes. Because as with all things model railway, you have two rails and your polarity is positive one side, negative the other. And for analog use, it switches depending on which direction you want the motor to go. So one set of wheels picks up the power from one end or one side, and the other set of wheels pick up the power from the other side. Now on these particular models, the pickups are actually quite nicely spread out. You've got this wheel here and this wheel here on both sides are live to the track, if you like. The middle one doesn't do anything, but you've got a decent spread of 4 points of pickup, which is actually quite good. And what you, the way it works is the wheels on one side, let me just have a quick look on this side here, are effectively earthed to the chassis. So the wheels are attached to a metal axle, which go through metal bearings into this metal chassis. And then the motor is screwed into the metal chassis with a metal screw and conducts the power through the metal of the chassis, the metal of the screw, the metal of the motor, up into here and then down this little bit of sprung wire here into this pickup strip, which ultimately ends up putting the power onto the commutator on the motor here. So that is how you get the power from that rail, which is effectively the left-hand rail, assuming it's traveling in a forwards direction. On the other side, if I spin it around, these wheels are not earthed to the chassis, because of course if they were, you'd have a short circuit. What these wheels have is a brass pickup strip just underneath here, attached to which is this brown wire, which comes out of the guts of the model underneath the motor. And then ultimately goes through this, under here is a resistor, and through this wire into this other pickup strip on the other side and attached, that conducts into that side of the commutator. And that completes your circuit, and that's how that motor works. So what we need to do with the new motor, ultimately, is to get power from the chassis, from the live chassis to one of these motor terminals, which will be the bottom one, and from that brown wire to the other motor terminal, which will be the top one. And that's fundamentally how this thing is going to work. But what we're going to do before that is give this motor a little bit of a clean, give the locomotive a little bit of a clean and remove the motor. Now you can see here the wheels are a bit grimy. And so it's a decent idea while we're doing this, while you've got your model apart, to clean it. And all you need to do that is a couple of cotton buds and a solvent fluid of your choice. A lot of people use IPA, isopropyl alcohol. I actually use lighter fluid. I find it's really, really effective. What I'm going to do is just use some crocodile clips that are connected to an analog controller I've got slightly off shop. Get some power to the motor. Get the wheels turning with the locomotive inverted so that I can then use these cotton buds to clean the wheels. So to get the motor turning, I need power onto the chassis. So I'm going to put it onto that screw head there. And then I need power onto the other side, if you like. So I'm just going to put a crocodile clip there. And then if I pop this into here, in theory, when I turn the power on, that starts turning. There we go, a bit reluctantly, which sort of shows why I might want to change the motor in this model. Turn it up a bit. Get it running. And then I'm just gonna wet my cotton bud with my solvent of choice. And then as the wheels are turning, just hold the cotton bud on them. Now you can see actually this doesn't have much power. I'm only pressing very lightly with that cotton bud, and that is really slowing those wheels down. And you can see how grimy that cotton bud's getting. So we're going to give that a good thorough clean. I'm going to do this to all of the wheels and I'll be back with you in a second. So I've cleaned those wheels and you can see just how dirty they were. Look at the state of those cotton buds. So you can see the importance of having cleaned them. The next thing we're going to do with the model as it is just oil the moving parts to make sure that it is going to run really nice and sweetly. Now you can see in here there's two little slots in the chassis here, and in those slots are the axles for the wheels. So with my oil dropper, I'm just going to put a little drop on each side of the axle, front and back. And I'm also going to just run a tiny bit of oil on that gear there. Now I don't need to do the whole gear because as it rotates and as the worm gear sort of spins over, it will spread the oil. I'm also going to put a tiny little drop of oil on the pivot points of the running gear. Less is more, you don't need much. And then having put that oil on, I'm going to apply power again so that the oil spreads around. I'm just going to run that for a minute or so and I'll be back with you. So here we are, having oiled and cleaned the motor. And you might notice what has happened in the process of me handling the model is that this red wire has become detached from this little tab here, which effectively tells me that the solder joint was quite old and weak. I didn't intend for that to happen, but it has happened. It doesn't matter. If that hadn't have happened, my next step would have been to use my soldering iron to soften the solder on this particular solder joint here so that I could detach that wire. But there we go, the age of the locomotive has saved me a job. What I need to do now is remove the motor itself, which is very simple. It's held on by one screw, and if I can, in fact I'm not gonna be able to show you that because it's not visible enough. What I was going to show you is that, so it's held on at the back end by this screw, and at the front end there's two little grooves in the chassis and two little legs, if you like, that stick out from the side of the motor that slot into those grooves to hold it in place at the front, to stop it lifting at the front. But all it is one screw at the back. Now we are going to reuse this screw, so it's one not to lose. So once you take it off, pop it in your pot and your motor is off. Simple as that. And putting the new one on is almost as simple. Now I'm going to draw your attention to this black wire, sorry, this brown wire here. Now that you might not be able to see, but attaches to a little copper or brass strip down in there, which is earthed to the chassis. And it is attached underneath this little bit of black tape here to an interference suppression capacitor, which bridges the chassis, which of course is earthed to the motor on the other terminal, and this wire here. Now I'm going to remove this because I'm not going to need it with my new motor, because the new motor will run much more efficiently. It's not going to generate that level of interference with televisions or things like that, like the old motor would have done back in the days of analog TV. Now, what has also happened is that brown wire has, rather annoyingly, just broken off down there, which means I've now got an extra job to do in terms of replacing that brown wire, which is why I give you 6 inches or so of this black wire, because there's every possibility that you're going to need to replace this wire here. There we go. So I can unscrew that little solder tab there and remove the suppression capacitor from the chassis. I'm going to keep that screw. It's just going to be in my spares pot. I'm not going to need to reuse it again. It's always worth keeping things like that in case you lose one of them. So here you have a naked chassis with no motor. Now, at this point, what I'm going to demonstrate is how well this model freewheels, if it does at all. So if I give it a push, it doesn't keep running very well at all, actually. But if I push it gently with my finger, it feels quite smooth. Now, there are some models, of which I think I have an example here, where you can run them and they have a bit of a stiff spot just there. I can feel it stiff there with every turn of that wheel. When that running gear is in the same position there, it has a stiff spot. And when this locomotive is running at slow speed, it will appear to jerk with every motion of the wheel, or every rotation of the wheel. It will hesitate slightly, and it will have this kind of cyclic jerking motion. Now, one thing I will mention about putting these new motors on models like that, a new motor won't solve that problem. The reason this model has that problem is there is either a slight bend in one of the axles or a slight quartering issue with one or more of the pairs of wheels. So if you have a model that when it's running at slow speed, you particularly notice a sort of jerking movement or a cyclical sort of stop start or a cyclical slowdown with every single one rotation of the wheels, changing the motor is not going to solve that problem. And I just wanted to let you know that, because the problem is not caused by the motor, it's caused by some other deformity or malfunction with the wheels or the running gear. So let's reattach this wire here. Now this is going to be a fiddly bit of the job. So I'm going to strip back a couple of mil of wire there, and I'm going to tin that piece of wire. There you go, it's nicely tinned. Now my soldering iron is nicely tinned. Now what I need to do, and you're not going to be able to see this on camera because it's just too small, but I can see, looking down there, there is a little brass tab, if you like, that I am going to need to tin. So just bear with me while I do this. Now, bearing in mind the gear right next to it is plastic. So I'm going to have to be very careful that I don't touch that gear, because if I melt that gear or deform that gear in any way, it's curtains. Right, there we go, that's tinned. And so now I can attach the wire. There you go, wire attached. That is, you'll be pleased to know, the most fiddly bit by a long way of doing this job. And there's every possibility that actually, if that brown wire hadn't have broken off and I would have checked it to see how secure it was, I wouldn't have bothered changing it. I would have left the original brown wire on and just attached the other end of that wire to the top of the new motor. So there's every possibility that you won't need to do that. So now, having attached that wire, the next thing I need to do is snip probably about an inch and a half off of that wire and attach it to the motor before I put the motor onto the chassis. So if I just snip a bit off there, now I'm going to put the chassis to one side and I'm going to bring in, one thing I didn't mention actually that you will need is one of these helping hands. They look a bit like a robot. There's a couple of crocodile clips and there is a little magnifying glass. What you're actually going to need is the crocodile clips on the stand to hold the motor in place so you can attach this wire and your little solder tab to the motor. So the first thing I'm going to do is attach that wire to the solder tab. Now the solder tab has two holes in it. I need to make sure that I don't obstruct the big hole, because the screw that was holding the original motor needs to go through that hole. So I'm just going to pop it in the crocodile clip here, and with this bit of wire, strip it back a couple of mil, if that, and then bring in your solder and soldering iron. I'm going to tin that bit of wire. I'm going to tin the solder tab, and then I'm going to attach wire to the solder tab. And I'm just going to blow that so it cools down, because the next thing I need to do is put it in this adapter here. Now, if you have a look at the adapter, underneath the flywheel is a little hole. Now, what you need to do is, with the end of the wire that's not attached to the solder tab, slide that wire through that hole, and you'll see that it will come out there. Now what you need to do is line up the hole on the solder tab with the hole on the adapter. But you do need, to be fair, you do need to do it sideways, because otherwise the solder tab will interfere with the flywheel. So having lined those two holes up, I'm going to bring in my helping hand again. And I'm going to hold them in place. So I've got the wire held in place. And you can see it sticking out here. Just there. Now what I need to do is solder that bit of wire to the motor terminal that's here. So with it in place, so I know how long it needs to be, I'm just going to snip off the excess and then I'm going to pull it back out again. I'm just going to strip it. I'm going to tin it. And then I need to tin the motor contact here. Now obviously be really careful because it's held inside a plastic casing. You don't want to touch the plastic casing with your soldering iron because you'll melt it. The motor, as it happens itself, has got a plastic frame. So you want to be quite quick and quite accurate with your soldering here. If you leave your soldering iron on that metal contact too long, you're going to start to melt some of the sort of fittings of the motor. So I'm going to just tin my soldering iron and then, being very careful not to touch any of the plastic stuff, just hold it on there for a few seconds. I'm just going to apply a little bit more there, but solder between there. There you go. Blow it dry. And there we go. That's tinned. So now if I bring my bit of wire back in, slide it through that hole, so it comes back out. Through there, he says. There you come. I have to take it off of here so I can see what I'm doing. If I put a little bend in it. There you go, out it comes. I can then make sure I line up my stripped and tinned bit of wire with the tinned bit of the motor and then hold it in place with my crocodile clip here. Now you'll see I have got a bit of excess here. That's deliberate because I need the wire to curve out of the way of the flywheel. But have the tinned bit of wire over the top of the tinned bit of the motor, and then with a bit of a solder, just a quick application there. If you've got any excess, you want to try and smooth it out a little bit. There we go. And now we can fit that onto the chassis. So this wire here tucks between the two wheels here and will tuck underneath the sort of frame, the bottom of the frame of the adapter. So what I'm going to do is just tuck it under there so it stays in place. I'm going to put the motor adapter on, and where you have the two little grooves in the chassis, one there and one the other side, the two little feet at the front of the motor adapter are going to slide into those grooves. And as they slide into those grooves, they will the feet on the adapter are slightly bigger by a fraction of a mil than those grooves. So what will happen is it will be stiff to get in. You need to give it a wobble side to side, and it will actually shave a little bit off of the adapter, and you'll end up with just a little bit of white sort of powder there, which can blow away. That means that that is a nice tight snug fit. The holes will line up there, and then what we're going to do is bend this wire out and sideways so it doesn't interfere with the flywheel, put that over that hole, and then bring in the screw that you took out when you originally took off the motor and put that through all three. So through the solder tab, through the motor fitting adapter into the chassis, and screw it down. There we go, and then I can give, if I loosen it off just a touch, sorry, I can just rotate that solder tab so that it's out of the way of the flywheel. and tighten it there. And what you need to do is just make sure that wire is not rubbing on the flywheel, because if it is, then what might happen is the wire will wear and you might end up perforating the sort of housing of the wire. So we haven't got much left to do. What we have got to do is bring in this other bit of wire that is now coming from underneath the new motor and attach it to the top of the motor just here. So I'm just going to cut it to length, giving myself a few mil spare. And again, strip it, tin it, and attach it. Tin the wire, tin the motor. And I'm going to bring in my tweezers for this one to hold that bit of wire in place. Attach it. Right, I bend that bit of wire up towards the top of the motor so it's not going to catch on the wheels. And there you are. Your X04 motor has been removed and your model is now fitted with a 5-pole skew wound motor with a flywheel. So let's put it on a track and see what it does. So here we are on the test track. I've got a rake of 5 coaches behind it. The purists among you are not going to particularly like the rake of coaches, but I wanted to get a decent length of coaches behind the locomotive just so you can see that it still has a decent amount of pulling power. This has got 5 coaches behind it. Obviously I'm a bit limited for space on my test track, but I have seen some of my beta testers pulling much longer rakes of freight wagons than the 5 coaches that I can fit on my little loop. I've made a couple of tiny little modifications to the locomotive. First thing I've added is just some self-adhesive weight here. One of the things I was struggling with was just a little bit of loss of traction with the wheels. I think because the drive wheels are quite old and they're a bit polished smooth, they were struggling with traction and there was a bit of wheel spin, which I didn't like. And then just here, I've put a little bit of black tack to make sure that this wire is tucked right out of the way of the flywheel and slides underneath the flywheel with a good millimetre or so of clearance, so it's not the flywheel's not rubbing on the wire. So let's get on with it, shall we, and let's see how it runs. So I'm obviously using just an analog controller, just a gauge master controller, and I will just turn the voltage up nice and slowly. We'll start with a little bit of a crawl like so, and then slowly turn the voltage up, a little bit of wheel spin there, and off we go. So that is at 50% on the controller. I'll go up to about 60 odd. And then we'll come right back down to a crawl as we bring it in for a stop. Now, as you'll hopefully see and agree, with this new 5-pole skew wound motor with the flywheel, the performance of the locomotive is massively improved compared to what it would have been with the old X04 motor. You saw when I serviced the locomotive with the X04 motor, it would barely turn when I lightly touched it with some cotton buds. Now it crawls really, really well, it pulls really, really well, and it's got a decent amount of speed as well. The top speed there was about 65-70% on the controller. So this is a really decent motor upgrade for those of you who have found your X04 motor has failed or is failing, or you just want to improve the performance of your model, or upgrade your model or convert your model to DCC. Now, incidentally, there will be another video in the not too distant future where I will do this installation again from the beginning, but rather than wire it up for analog, it will be wired up for digital. So those of you who want to do so, there will be a separate video that will show you how to do it. But there we go. I hope that that's been useful and enjoyable. And I do hope, sincerely hope, that these motor modifications will allow you to keep your old vintage locomotive stock running and running for many, many years in the future. Thanks very much for watching. Take care. I'll see you soon.